that in our thought, when we're thinking about things, we're always attending to or focusing on particular features of them. So I'm not just thinking about Harvard University. You might be thinking of Memorial Hall or thinking about the green in the center of the university or something of that kind. So we need to understand how thought can be selective in the way in which it attends to things.
Meanwhile, in France, Henri Bergson was a great influence on William James. He is perhaps best known for coining the phrase the vital spirit.
Bergson was a philosopher who took evolution very seriously. I think he'd probably been influenced by Darwin's writings. But he rejected the sort of mechanistic basis for evolution that Darwin offered. Indeed, he wanted to think that evolution did involve some kind of progress, that through time things were getting better, whereas the Darwinian story doesn't allow for that possibility at all. So he claimed that evolution was in a way driven by a sort of creative urge or a vital spirit, which was a kind of explanatory principle, I suppose, that would have no place in mechanistic physical accounts of how the world works. I think he thought that the same process was actually present to us in our consciousness, in the way in which we make decisions, because we were aware of the ways in which our choices are influenced by memories, influenced by the past. But we're also aware, he thought, that they're not determined by the memories, that we are actually free to choose and indeed free to make things better. So either way, this reference to progress gives us a rather optimistic view of things, optimism about what we can do, and also optimism about the way things are going. But it's interesting that it carries with it a commitment to a sort of vital spirit, an explanatory principle that has no place in the physical sciences or anything of that sort. So it carries with it the thought that in explaining living things in biology and in psychology and so on, we have to appeal to, well, a doctrine that's often called vitalism, the thought that there is this vital spirit there as an additional explanatory mechanism.
In creative evolution, Bergson says the whole universe must be seen in historical terms. Every stage is a development of what has gone before. The present contains nothing more than the past, and what is found in the effect was already in the cause. Ludwig Wittgenstein was born in Vienna in 1889, but became a naturalized British citizen. He initially trained as an engineer, but from 1912 to 1913, he studied mathematical logic under Russell. Like Russell, Wittgenstein was interested in language and its uses. The limits of my language mean the limits of my world.
What Wittgenstein's interested in is ordinary language, the kind of language that we use all the time, not some ideal equivalent that philosophers may be able to set up.
In later life, Wittgenstein became disillusioned with some of the theories he had propounded in the Tractatus.
You get the impression when you're reading the Tractatus that it's as if he thinks that the only basic linguistic move that's of any concern is the move of saying what things are like, saying what is the case, to go back to the very first sentence of the Tractatus. And of course that is something that we often do. We give each other information, we pass on information to each other in all sorts of ways, and we can be right or wrong as the case may be. If you ask me for instructions to get to somewhere, I can give you directions, and those directions may be correct or incorrect as the case may be. But he later began to realize that that's by no means all that we do with language. There are all sorts of other things that we do as well as just convey information. We greet one another, we thank one another, we praise each other and blame each other for various things. A whole variety of different linguistic moves that we make that hadn't really been recognized in the earlier work, or so he later thought.
Wittgenstein's views began to change in later life. It is only since his death in 1951 that much of this has come to light. Many of his texts and lectures were published posthumously. These included the Blue and Brown books, typescript copies of lectures he gave at Cambridge. Their influence was significant. In Philosophical Investigations, Wittgenstein deals with language and numbers. He begins with what he calls language games.
When Wittgenstein in his later work talks about language games, really this is a metaphor for helping us to understand the variety of different things that we can do with language other than just talk about what is the case or convey information to each other. So when people greet each other in the street and say hi or hello or how are you, for Wittgenstein, they're playing a kind of language game. They're making moves in a game which don't consist in conveying information. When you say hi, you're not conveying information to another person, you're greeting them. And the other example that I mentioned earlier was thanking. Somebody gives you something and you express your thanks. Again, that's not a way of conveying information. That's a particular kind of move that we sometimes make in a very important language game that we sometimes play. The point is simply to remind us of the huge variety of different things that we can do with language.
He also deals with rules for the development of series, such as that of numbers.
Wittgenstein was very interested in the whole question of rules and following rules in his later philosophy, although I think perhaps people have sometimes exaggerated his interest because they've thought that what he was claiming was that language is always governed by precise rules, which actually, it seems to me, is in direct violation of the point that we were just making. It's not always governed in very precise ways by precise rules. And there are plenty of linguistic games that develop in a rather unregulated way.
For a large class of cases, though not for all, in which we employ the word meaning, it can be defined thus. The meaning of a word is its use in language. Perhaps the most controversial section of the book is that dealing with the naming of sensations. It has been seen as a revolt against the Cartesian framework.
On the Cartesian view, it's as if there's a little private theatre that we each carry around with us and that we're observing what's going on that private stage. And Wittgenstein says, well, the reason that we think like that is that we're once again forgetting the huge variety of different ways in which language can function. So that, to take one very simple example, think about the claim, I'm in pain. Suppose that you're asking me whether a part of my body hurts or not, and I say, yes, I am feeling some pain at the moment, or yes, it does hurt, or whatever. We're inclined to think, as Wittgenstein himself perhaps would have thought when he wrote the Tractatus, that what this is a commentary on what the world is like, that it's a way of conveying information in the same way that I might tell you that there's a chair over there. I'm now telling you that there's a pain in my leg. And the question then arises, okay, what's the nature of this information that I'm conveying? What am I commenting on? What am I reporting on? And once you raise that question, it's then not very long before you're going to be starting to think about this in Cartesian terms. Think, well, the pain is something that only I have access to. So when I'm telling you that I'm in pain, obviously that's something that I can know in a way that you can't. It must be because I'm talking about this little private world that I carry around with me. And Wittgenstein says, well, no. We're forgetting that language does function in a huge variety of ways. And although I'm in pain is a little bit like there's a chair over there, in other ways it's very unlike that. And we could just as well think of it on the model of simply saying, ouch, which is another way, another linguistic way in which people react to pain, a much more simple, much more primitive linguistic reaction to pain. But nevertheless, that's part of the language that children have to learn. And that